revolution time.
My name is John Campbell, and I'm a university lecturer at the University of the Western Indies at St. Augustine, Trinidad. I was born and I grew up in the island of Trinidad, more specifically from the southern part of Trinidad in a place called Santa. I enjoy, actually, where I grew up. It's not too much of a city, even though it has the term city now. By the time that I grew up there, it was a relatively rural place in the sense that there weren't many cars in the streets in front, etc. So we did run around in the yard. I am accustomed to running around barefoot, actually, so my feet have become quite hard, and people sometimes wonder how I could have come in now for an interview on my feet up here, but that's how I like it. I played marble pitch and a lot of the other games that I see now today, many of these city children really don't have time for. It was an age before the computers, and where we had ball games, we had climbing trees, and these kind of activities, what I remember from my childhood growing up in San Fernando at the time that I did. So I look back now with very, very fond memories of where I was in terms of a childhood beginning and where I am now in terms of a lectureship at the university. I suspect the most exciting aspect of my job really is meeting people. My course that I teach is a course that almost all the university students must do. As such, on an average semester, say like this semester, I would teach over 2,000 students at one go. It's always very exciting because you meet people from all backgrounds. I teach day students, I teach evening students, I teach part-time students, and I even teach students in an open university, that is overseas students. The reality is that on any given day, I don't know who I will encounter, and I don't know what exactly will be, you know, their background or their story. So it's always the sense of newness and always the sense of interest in the people over and above the material that I teach. It's about present civilization. But the people I encounter is really not as straightforward. And that is the exciting part about what I do. Well, oftentimes when I think about how I got to where I am today, I sometimes am a bit surprised or amazed. As I said in an earlier part, when I started off as a normal child with normal expectations. I'm going to school, primary school, secondary school, etc. And just wanting a job. At school, I was attracted to the area of history. I thought about going to the university, but I didn't because there were no pressing things. In my mind, one of the most pressing things was getting a job and earning money. Therefore, I started off as a primary school teacher. I enjoyed it. I spent about 4 or 5 years, but somehow, the love of history and the desire to accomplish what I really like doing remained there. And thought seriously, I realized that the only way in which I could accomplish what I wanted to do was through more education. So as difficult as it was in the short run, I had to stop teaching. I had a nice little primary school job teaching in a rural area. Again, when I say rural, I'm talking about cows going into the playing field of the schoolyard, etc. So it was a very rural, comfortable setting. And I moved to the university area because I had to. I realized it was necessary for my advancement. And so I studied at the university. I was serious about the study. I was able to get a scholarship where I went to Cambridge University in England, and I completed my studies there. And again, it was difficult because the reality is that you have to give up the things that you are accustomed to and the things that are normal and the things that are everyday in order to move forward. You have to go in a new environment. I had to adjust to new cultures. I had to be away from my family, etc. But I did, but just for a while. And so I went to England, studied there, etc. And upon completion, the first job that I got was actually in Jamaica. So I didn't even come back immediately to Trinidad. But I enjoyed my time in Jamaica, and I spent about 5 years there before coming back to Trinidad to take up a teaching appointment here. When I look back again, it was unplanned in the sense that I never knew the different countries I would have to go to. I never knew beforehand all of the work that I would have to do. However, what I did know was that I had to be committed and I had to be serious about what I was doing. And so long as I was steadfast in my commitment, I knew that I would eventually achieve. And thank goodness I have achieved today. In thinking about the current status that I have achieved and the difficulties along the way, I look back now and I wouldn't say I look back with joy, because the reality is difficulties are often never pleasant, which is not to say that they are not instructive or that they are not useful for building character. But the reality is that when one goes through, as I did, go through these difficulties, the moments of going through them are very disheartening, and at times you would feel to give up. One of the things that I remember is the sense of loneliness when I was studying abroad. You have no support structures, simple things like talking over problems that you have during the day, or going to get some food, etc., which you know, relatively easy in places like Trinidad. Feeling hungry, there is no such thing as hunger, because you can always go up a mango tree and grab a mango, some fruit somewhere. The reality is, if you try doing that in certain other places, you would immediately go to jail. And it was difficult adjusting to different cultures. So there would be times, of course, when you'd be hungry, and I'm not saying hungry in a very, very drastic way, but hungry day to day, sometimes as a student, you can't make ends meet, etc. So there are times when you would not be as well fed as you would like to be. There are times when you would not be as comforted as you would like to be. And all these difficulties I look back at and think now that, you know, I had to go through that. I look back also at people who should have been helpful. And oftentimes when you try to better yourself or you try to move forward, the reality is that not everyone is as supportive as they should be. And one of the things that I remember comes from the fact that people who I thought would have been helpful or who I thought would have been offering assistance did not. One has to be clear in one's mind, as I was clear in my mind, that in order to achieve, it is really up to the individual, and you cannot let the difficulties outside of you dishearten you such that you give up. You cannot let lack of help, you cannot let negativity from others influence you to the point of not striving. And so you have to force yourself, at times you have to force yourself and focus on what you want to achieve and why you're achieving that. And this is the basis upon, you know, my overcoming the difficulties, and there were many, but my overcoming the difficulties that allowed me to be where I am today. You have to be clear in your mind where you want to go. Not only just be clear in your mind, but you have to be clear how to achieve where you want to go. Oftentimes, a student will have a clear idea as to where they want to go or how they want to end up, what job they want to have, etc. But in order to achieve that job, the tip that I will give you is to make a workable plan. And this plan must not be a long-term plan. You must not simply say, well, in 10 years' time, I want to see myself in this particular position or with these assets. What you have to do is you have to break down the time from 10 years to 5 years to 1 year to just a month. And this is what I did, and I found it very useful for my success. and you break it down to a month or even a week and say, what do I have to achieve in 1 week in order to allow my whole 10-year plan to be on schedule? And you can constantly assess yourself in that way. A month, 2 months, 3 months, etc. And you ensure that you are constantly working and you are constantly achieving in order to get to your final goal. The other point that I would make concerns advice. And an important part of achieving success is getting the correct advice. Oftentimes, the road to success, like any road or like any map, needs proper signposts. So if you want to get from one town to another town, you are going along the way and you look for the signposts in order to know that you're on the right track. If the signposts are missing, or if the names have been changed or moved, you well know how difficult it is to arrive at your destination. My tip to you, therefore, is that you must ensure that you have good signposts, you have reliable signposts, you have legitimate signposts. Very crucial for that journey. Therefore, you have to ensure that at each point, you are getting proper advice from people who are knowledgeable in the area or people who can give you some insights. It does not necessarily mean that you have to follow all of the advice that you are given, but what it does mean is that you have to be able at any point in time to have the advice available to you so that you can decide which advice or which good advice you will ultimately take. The whole road to success ultimately depends on the individual, because no matter how good the plan, no matter how much good insights you have or how much good assistance you have, ultimately the student has to be resolute, the person has to be clear in their mind that they want to achieve. In my case, I wanted to achieve for a number of reasons. One most pressing one was the context of my family. My family always prided education, they always prided upward mobility as a marker of success and as a legitimizing factor for you as an individual. And therefore, I wanted again to achieve not just for myself, but for my larger family. At times when I was lonely in the UK, at times when I was disappointed or disheartened, at times when I wanted to give up, and of myself, I would have given up, I kept on going because in my mind, the success that I was aiming for wasn't just for me, but was for a larger family group. And I know that if I failed, I would not only fail for myself, but I would be disappointing and I would be failing a larger group. I think that was, again, pivotal to understanding success, that when you get on board this journey, you have to be clear in your mind that you are not an individual for yourself, but that your success acts not only as a support to other people seeking success, but in a very real way, your success will encourage others to succeed as well and will ultimately go for the good of the larger group. You are not an individual in success. I always think about the parable about the worker who was given talents or who was given certain good things, etc., and who. And again, this is I'm cutting short the story because I appreciate the point. The worker was taught that, listen, if you have talent, if you have good things given to you, etc., you have a responsibility to not just hold them in hand, but to, again, spread them out to the larger community, to the larger group, or to multiply them. In that sense, therefore, I don't see my success, or I don't see where I am, for the things I do as an individual effort for individual reward. I always look at the wider community, and when I look at the wider community, there is the community I serve, and there is the community that I came from. Oh, ultimately, that I have a responsibility to both these communities, the communities to which I serve, and the community from which I came, and therefore I have to give back to them. The ways in which I give back to them are many. On the one hand, there is, again, the financial or the physical way in which you can render assistance, and that is always necessary. And there will always be opportunities to do that. What I think is a deeper level is giving of oneself. And I always try to get involved in self-help programs, just like this one, and programs that assist people in their development. There's a common saying that says, if you give a man a fish, you feed him for a day, but if you teach him to fish, you feed him for a lifetime. And I see programs that work towards building up youth, and programs that work towards encouraging youth as more than a one-off assistance. I see those programs as being continuously of assistance to the community, and those are the kind of programs that I like to get myself involved with. So how do I give back ultimately? I give back through giving of myself, through giving time, through giving my insight, through assisting students with homework projects, homework plans, through assisting students in letting them come and talk to me about what they want to do and how best they can achieve it. And so long as I am able to give sensible tips, so long as I am able to render assistance, I feel that that is, in fact, a very, very good way of giving back to the community. I think that I want to help rural inner community children that this organization serves, because these children, the common term is, are more at risk. But what does it really mean? It means that on the field of experience, on the field of life, everyone does not start off on the equal footing. That is the reality of it. And there are some people who, for a number of reasons, oftentimes the reasons are not because of themselves, are start off without as much advantages as others. And therefore, there is a real need, there is a real need to respond, to identify and respond to the needs of these children, to respond to the needs of these people, to respond to these individuals in a more than proportionate manner in order to even out the playing field. When we look at these cases where we see special attention needs to be given, it is not special in the sense that it is extraordinary, but it is special in the sense that it is necessary attention in order to avert a tragedy. Tragedy of life, a tragedy of the unequal sharing of resources. And we need each one of us as individuals to respond to this need. And therefore, it's in this sense that I see these projects or projects geared towards children or young people in rural areas, young people in communities that are not economically viable as other communities, in communities that are disadvantaged in the sense that they don't have the kind of opportunities that other communities have. I see the need to outreach to these communities and especially go in and encourage these young people and children, because one of the hard aspects of coming from a community that does not have all of the resources is the reality that people in these communities begin to lose interest in trying to move forward, in trying to aspire to something more, trying to get ahead. They lose interest and they become disheartened. And it is important just to allow these people the opportunity to realize that all is not lost and that in fact they can make a difference and that there are people interested in assisting them in making a difference. And the assistance just comes from the encouragement, because in these communities as well, we have to realize that ability is an evening medium, and ability is there. And all that is needed is basic encouragement for these individuals, again, to surpass many of their colleagues who have a better start in life. So again, the encouragement is necessary, and I see myself, whenever I get the opportunity, as having to go forward and assist in this area. My name is John Campbell, and I am Shashamane's son. I'm John Campbell, and I'm a university lecturer at the University of the Western Indies at St. Augustine, Trinidad. But I want to say to the young people out there that you have to keep in mind that in order to be great, you do not have to have a great name, or you do not have to achieve one objective that everybody knows you for. In order to be great, you have to try, in whatever situation you are, to be the best at what you want to be. So long as you are the best in what you want to be, you are a success. That may mean that you can be the best housewife, the best mother, the best father. These are individuals who are pivotal in success of the community. You do not have to turn to crime, you do not have to turn to drugs, etc. for the support facilities in order to be of your best. Trust in yourself, trust in organizations like Shashamane Sunrise to again give to you the kind of support you need to be your best. And so long as you are your best, you will ultimately be a success.
Go ahead.
My name is John Campbell, and I am a Shashamane Sunrise volunteer.